Praise the Lord. Dearly beloved sisters and brothers, on the 45th day of our Bible pilgrimage, Father is here greeting you in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. This is a beautiful day as we are completing the book of Exodus with the last two chapters we have read today and reflected. And we read also Psalms, the third Psalm, and having completed the book of the Gospel of Mark, we are today entering into the third Gospel, that is Gospel of Luke. I invite your attention to the last two sentences of Exodus 39. The Israelites had done all the work just as the Lord had commanded Moses. Moses examined everything and saw that they had made it all just as the Lord had commanded. So Moses blessed them because they obeyed exactly what the Lord had commanded. Moses blessed them. Blessing is always connected with obedience. Praise the Lord. How much importance God gives to this tent of meeting, the tabernacle and the Ark of the Covenant inside, and everything connected with that. So we have seen from chapter 25 to 31, like, you know, in detail, God is giving out his heart actually. What is in his heart? He is showing Moses. Then they are obeying, you know, they are doing it. They are making it from verse chapter 35 onwards. It's the obedience. They are doing it. And chapter 39, they have completed. Moses examined everything and he was satisfied and he blessed them. Actually, it's the blessing of God through Moses to the people. Praise the Lord. Now, chapter 40, the first sentence. The Lord said to Moses, on the first day of the first month, you shall erect the tabernacle of the tent of meeting, and you shall put in it the Ark of the Covenant, and you shall screen the Ark with the veil. And so remember, first day of the first month. And verse 16, thus did Moses, according to all that the Lord commanded him, so he did. So, and in the first month, in the second year, on the first day of the month, the tabernacle was erected. So, the second year means the first month, last year, first month, on date 14, they had left Egypt. So now, the second year, first month, first day. So almost 1 year, just 14 more days means 1 year will be completed after leaving Egypt. So, where is the place now they are? At Sinai. When did they reach there? 50th day after leaving Egypt, they had reached. So, from that time till today, they are where? They are at Sinai. And what they were doing this time? They were making this Ark of the Covenant and the Tent of Meeting. Praise the Lord. So, this particular thing is of great importance in the life of Israelites and so our lives too. So we will come back to the importance of the Ark of the Covenant and the Tent of Meeting these days. Okay, I would try to give you more explanation about that because it's of really great importance in our spiritual journey and spiritual life. Praise the Lord. So before leaving Exodus, I want you to come to meditate on one more sentence, that is 34th verse. Then the cloud covered the tent of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. This has some connection with Luke chapter 1. Today we were reading that Luke chapter 1, verse 35. And the angel said to her, Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Dear ones, the words used there are exactly the same. That's what the scriptural scholars tell us. Dear ones, these two texts are interconnected, and this is of very great spiritual importance, because the scriptural scholars say the words used in both the places are of same meaning, one in Hebrew and one the other in New Testament in Greek. For example, the cloud covered the tent of meeting, the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. And the same thing while coming to Luke chapter 1:35, Holy Spirit will come upon you and God's power will overshadow you or fill you. See, this brings the connection between the Ark of the Covenant in the Old Testament and the Ark of the Covenant in the New Testament, that is Mary herself. We will come to know more about that later. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Now let us try to see the third psalm. Actually, this is the first psalm with a title. Title is this, A Psalm of David When He Fled From Absalom, His Son. So the events at the background of this psalm is recorded in 2 Samuel chapters 15 onwards. But the heart of David at that difficult time is recorded in this psalm. So that is the textual meaning. But the spiritual meaning coming out of this is a messianic. According to many church fathers like St. Augustine and Chrysostom and so on, it is about Jesus. The sufferings, the persecution, the opposition that Jesus had gone through. So, but we shall look at it from the textual and a historical perspective. That is because it is so beautiful to see how this man called David kept the peace amidst the stormy situation in which he was. So the first two sentences, I have so many enemies, Lord, so many who turn against me, they talk about me and say, God will not help him. Actually, the number of enemies had increased because at the writing of the psalm, David was in a great deal of trouble. His own son led what seemed to be a successful rebellion against him, and so many who were with David, associates and friends, they forsook him and joined the ranks of those who troubled him. That is written in 2 Samuel chapter 15 verse 30. And they were telling what God will not help him. You know, David's situation was so bad that many felt he was beyond God's help. See, those who said this probably didn't feel that God was unable to help David, but they probably felt that God was unwilling to help him. They looked at David's past sin and figured this is all what he deserves from God. So there is no help for him in God. And Shimei is the best example for someone who said that God was against David. And he was on the way. This man, Shimei, was cursing David and trying to stone him. So all these things we will see later. But, you know, it is this thought was most painful of all for David, actually. The thought that God might be against him and that there is no help for him in God. For anyone for that matter, you know, this is the most tragic thing that can happen among all the sufferings. You know, when you find that God is not there for you, that's the time many people think of committing suicide and, you know, they leave and go, like, you know, because there is no hope. They fall into depression. They have no more help, no more aid wherein you can hold on. So that situation. See, one preacher called Charles Spurgeon, actually he's not a Catholic preacher, but still, I I liked one sentence that he said. You know, it's like this. If all the trials which come from heaven, all the temptations which ascend from hell, and all the crosses which arise from the earth could be mixed and pressed together, they would not make a trial so terrible as that which is contained in this verse. It is the most bitter of all afflictions to be led to fear that there is no help for us in God. That is the most terrible affliction that can happen. That's what this person called Spurgeon, and he is called actually by many prince of preachers. Mighty preaching he had. Whatever it be, let us go ahead. You know, when people were accusing David like this, but what David say, you know, verse 3, "But you, O Lord, are always my shield from danger. You give me victory and restore my courage. I call to the Lord for help. From his sacred hill, he answers me. O Lord, you are a shield for me." See, it's beautiful. Though many said there was no help for him in God, David knew that God was his shield. Others, even many others, couldn't shake David's confidence in a God of love and help. See, under attack from a cunning and ruthless enemy, David needed a shield. He knew that God was his shield. So this wasn't a prayer asking God to fulfill this, but instead, this is a strong declaration of his faith. He is telling, "You are my shield." He is not praying, "You be my shield." No. So he says, "You, O Lord, are my shield." So that is a word of courage and word of testimony, word of faith and trust. And then he says, "My glory and the one who lifts my head. You are my glory." See, God was more than David's protection here. He also was the one who put David on higher ground, lifting his head and showing him glory. Actually, he was in a very gloomy situation, and there was nothing glorious or head lifting in David's circumstances because it was disgraceful. His own son causing all this thing, and family was almost in a ruin like that time. But he says, "He is my glory, and he will help me to lift up my head." What a beautiful testimony it is. "Then I cried to the Lord with my voice, and he heard me from his holy hill." You know, others said that God wanted nothing to do with David, but he could gloriously say, "He heard me." Though Absalom took over Jerusalem and forced David out of the capital, David knew that it wasn't Absalom enthroned on God's holy hill. Lord himself still held that ground, and would, you know, God himself is doing that, you know, later for him, you know, and bringing him back to the holy hill. So he is proclaiming his faith, and that happens to him. You know, we need to claim the promises of God. Then the last beautiful things, like, you know, he says, "I lie down and sleep, and all night long the Lord protects me. I'm not afraid of the thousands of enemies who surround me on every side." David used both of these as evidence of God's blessing. What is that? Sleep. Sleep was a blessing because David was under such intense pressure from the circumstances of Absalom's rebellion that sleep might be impossible. That is the time when anyone can lose sleep. But this man say, "I lie down and I sleep." That is the trust. You know, faith, he explained. Now it is trust. I lie down. Sleep is such, you know, that was a great blessing for him. So he is accepting, this is a great blessing that I could sleep well under that circumstances. Then he says, "I wake up I lie down and sleep, and all night long the Lord protects me." So the another translation here is, In Good News Bible, that is not there, but I go to RSV Bible here. I wake again for the Lord sustains me. That is there. So, waking was another blessing, because many wondered if David would live to see another day. That is like that. So, for him, it was another great blessing. So, God sustains us in our sleep, but we take it for granted usually. See, think of it. You are asleep, unconscious, dead to the world, yet you breathe and your heart pumps, your organs operate. The same God who sustains us in our sleep will sustain us in our difficulties. That's what the meaning of this thing, you know. So we should not take the blessings of the Lord for granted. Even when we are asleep, His power is working. So He says, I am not afraid of 10,000 of people. If God is for us, who can be against us? Actually, what is written in Romans chapter 8, 31. So He is blessing the Lord. Now, claiming the blessings from the Lord, now what comes forth is He is blessing the Lord. He is thanking and praising God, saying, You come, Lord, come. And verse 7 is like this, Arise, O Lord. Actually, this Arise, O Lord, this recall the words of Numbers chapter 10, verse 35, where Moses used this phrase as the children of Israel broke camp in the wilderness. It was a military phrase calling on God to go forth to both defend Israel and lead them to victory. So it's like that. It's a victory phrase. Actually, it is Arise, O Lord. And then he says, You punish all my enemies and leave them powerless to harm me. And the words he uses, they have broken the teeth of the ungodly. This is written again in Psalm 58:6. It speaks of the total domination and defeat of the enemy. So, David is completely trusting in the Lord. And the last sentence, he says, deliverance belongs to the Lord. Thy blessing be upon thy people. He is not only claiming blessing for himself. And he says, deliverance is the work of the Lord, and his blessing be upon his people. So he is blessing all his people. In his distress, he is not thinking about himself. He is thinking of the people also. That is a righteous person. Hallelujah. First chapter of Luke brings so many spiritual messages that I feel like taking one full hour at least and explaining to you, but we have our time limit and so we can't go into, but limiting to one or two questions, you know, two messages. Someone asked me for an explanation. Question is this. See, Angel Gabriel punishes Zachariah by rendering him mute, you know. But later in the gospel, verse 62, yeah, people are making signs to talk to him as if he were deaf. So, were they confused and just thought him deaf as well? What is the meaning like, you know? See, I was just trying to get the answer for that. At least one of the church fathers, Theophylact, offers a linguistic explanation and notes that the word in the Greek used is kophos. In addition to muteness, may also signify being deaf and mute. And he says Zachariah reasonably suffered these two things. That's what he says. And he says deafness is a suitable punishment because faith comes by hearing. Thus, doubting the faith of God's word through Gabriel, Zachariah is punished by the temporary loss of hearing. Further, that he might not lead others to lack of faith or to scoffing, he is rendered mute. The first punishment is salutary for him. The second part of the punishment is salutary for others. So that is the explanation he gives. Another question is many people asking the same question, like, you know, whether, you know, both of them, like Zachariah and Mary, their reply was almost similar, but only Zachariah was punished, the other one spared. And what is the reason? You know, actually, we can note, Zachariah doubts about a matter of nature that God has overridden before. When I say, you understand, that is, for example, he enabled Abraham and Sarah to conceive in old age. So that had happened. Being a priest, he knew it very clearly. But Mary wonders, due to a vow of virginity she has already rendered to God. Thus, she regards God, while Zacharias seemingly doubts God. Also, Mary immediately gave the beautiful words, I am the handmaid, let his will be done to me. So she, from her part, is fully proclaiming her obedience only. So that is the answer. And we have a lot more spiritual messages, but we end here. And the coming time, we will have more explanations. And in this chapter, we have the prayer, Hail Mary, fully seen here. Hail Mary, full of grace, Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb, Jesus. Dear ones, this is fully biblical. And then follows the prayer of the church. The church is praying through the intercession of Mary. May Almighty God bless each one of us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.